This is The Witness. Not a trial, not a court of law, not a legislative inquiry, but a simulated hearing before a simulated committee. A committee representing the morality and the conscience of today, with the power to call before it the famous, the infamous, the evil and controversial figures of yesterday. Tonight's witness, Jimmy Hines. And here he comes now, Jimmy Hines, one of the most powerful political bosses of New York City during the late 20s and 30s. Tonight, the committee will probe into the often repeated rumor that many of the city's top racketeers and gangsters not only look to Hines for protection against the law, but that he is, in fact, a partner, a participant in many of their vicious undertakings that extort millions every year from the public. This hearing will be getting underway very shortly, but for now, we return you to our studios.
This portion of The Witness is brought to you by Camel, the real cigarette, an exclusive blend of costly Turkish and domestic tobaccos. The best tobacco makes the best smoke.
Ever heard of a man who can literally walk up a wall? A human fly? Well, now you're looking at one, 700 feet up. He's Orrin Murray, field survey engineer, working on the second highest dam in the United States, the fabulous Glen Canyon Dam, being built by the U.S. Bureau of Reclamation in Arizona. This real man smokes America's real cigarette, Camel. He's tried other brands, but he says Camel suit him best. For rich taste, easygoing mildness, real smoking satisfaction, nothing beats a Camel. Honestly now, how does your cigarette measure up to Camel? Does it give you all this real satisfaction? Or are you smoking more these days but enjoying it less? Then by all means, change to Camels. The Camel blend of costly Turkish and domestic tobaccos has never been equal for the enjoyment you want each and every time you light up. The best tobacco makes the best smoke. Have a real cigarette. Have a Camel.
Down in the hearing room, the probe into the career of New York politician Jimmy Hines is just about ready to get underway. This is the chairman of the committee, Mr. Paul McGrath, seated at the hearing table, talking with a member of the committee, Mr. Charles Hayden. On Mr. Hayden's right is Mr. Frank A. Milan and Mr. William W. Smithers. We're ready to get underway. Here's Chairman McGrath.
All right. All right, I'll call this session to order. Now, I'll ask the reporters and photographers to keep the aisles in this front area cleared. Keep it clear, gentlemen. Now, I'll remind the spectators that they are here as guests of the committee. You are most welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Please be seated. But you must obey our rules of procedure. There will be no demonstrations of any kind. Mr. Clerk, will you call James J. Hines?
James J. Hines! James J. Hines, please. Raise your right hand. You solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
State your full name.
James J. Hines.
Be seated, please.
Thank you.
Now, Mr. Hines, you are entitled to legal counsel, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. But I'm sure that I'll need no other counsel than the sure knowledge of my innocence of any charges of wrongdoing.
Very well. Be seated, sir. Now, Mr.
Chairman, I just like interrupting, but I have a few remarks I'd like to get off my chest right here at the opening.
Well, very well. If you have an opening statement, the committee will be very happy to hear it.
But without impugning your motives or the impartiality of the committee, I'd like to say that I can think of a much more rewarding experience than waiting here like a sitting duck for the buckshot to fly. For two reasons. One, I've been through all this before and come away smelling like a rose, if you'll excuse the expression. And two, it so happens that I've got two tickets to the baseball game this afternoon, and it looks like I'm not going to be able to make it. And right on the third baseline, too.
You'll find a lot more news at Polo Grounds than you will down here, boys. I guarantee you that, so on me.
All right, if you please. We've had our joke. Now, does that conclude your statement, Mr. Hines?
It concludes mine, Mr. Chairman, and now I'd like to hear yours. And you might begin by telling me why your committee has decided to have me over the coals.
Well, I think we can accommodate you on that score. Crime and racketeering have reached such proportions in New York City that the citizens are crying aloud for action. Gambling, prostitution, extortion. All these have risen to a point where one can only conclude that every law enforcement agency of New York has broken down. The citizens are afraid to walk on the streets. Businessmen are deserting
New
York.
Oh, now, Mr. Chairman.
Now, you ask for a bill of particulars, Mr. Hines.
Well, sure, if you're going to give me a list of the things that are bad in New York, I'll give you a list of my own. Oh, the subways are dirty. The traffic condition is frightful. Garbage pickup is undependable. And there are holes in the streets. Now, you're going to blame James J. Hines for that. Now I am, if I got a lot of New York in me, but I am not the city itself.
Mr. Hines, let's get down to the facts of the matter, please, sir. You are the Tammany leader of the 11th Assembly District in New York City.
That I am.
When were you elected to this office, sir?
1920.
Yes. And since that time, you have become one of the most powerful figures in the New York City politics.
Modesty prevents me from denying that, but where do we go from here?
Suppose we go to Welfare Island.
I wouldn't advise that. The view is good, but the food is lousy.
Now, sir, the city of New York maintains a correctional institution on Welfare Island.
You mean a prison?
That's what I mean, sir.
Well, why don't you call it a prison?
Now, Mr. Hines, what do you know about a prisoner at Welfare Island named Vic March?
Vic March? Never heard the name.
You never heard of Vic March?
Doesn't strike a bell.
Mr. Chairman, suppose we try to jog Mr. Hines' memory. Could we call Mr. Stephen Morris?
Clerk, will you call Stephen Morris?
Stephen Morris! Stephen Morris! Raise your right hand, slap on the Bible. Do you solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Sure, I do.
State your full name.
Stephen Morris.
Be seated, please.
Now, Mr. Morris, did you recently serve a term at the Welfare Island prison?
Yeah, I was there for a while.
And while you were at Welfare Island, did you know one Vic March?
Know one Vic March? You mean there's more?
Did you know Vic March?
Certainly I knew Vic March. Everybody out there knows Vic March. Whether you like it or not, you know him. Next time I go out, I'm going to know him better.
Well, why would you know him better?
Because now I'm wised up. You live, you learn. I learn.
Just what did you learn, Mr. Morris?
I learned that when Vic March sneezes, even the warden yells Gesundheit.
All right. Mr. Milan asked you, just what did you learn about Vic March?
Okay, I'll give you a few for instances. Look, you play cards, you cut the pot for March. You get thirsty, March runs a brewery.
Now, wait just a minute, Mr. Morris. A brewery in a prison?
Certainly. Well, you get as dry there as any place else. He runs his brewery. Now, look, you want better eats, March gets them in. You don't like your bed? For a little consideration, March fixes you up with a nice spot in the infirmary. For money, he takes care of everything.
Well, how does he get away with this in a prison?
Why shouldn't he get away with it? He collects the tickets.
Now, please, you must answer the questions clearly, sir.
Thank you, Mr. McGrath. Now, what tickets does he collect?
The kind I'm going to get the next time I go over. Look, you come in, you give March the ticket, and you're entitled to all the special considerations I told you about.
Oh, and how do you come by one of these tickets?
You come by it by going up to Harlem and buying it from Jimmy Hines.
I see. In other words, Mr. Morris, if you want to buy special privileges while you're in this jail, you go up to Hines' club, you buy a ticket, you turn it over to this Vic March, and from then on, you're living in the lap of luxury, right?
Well, it's not exactly like living at the Waldorf, but the rates are a lot lower.
Thank you very much, Mr. Morris.
Anything further, Mr. Milan?
No more questions.
Mr. Smithers, Mr. Hayden. All right, you may cross-examine, Mr. Hines.
I wouldn't think of wasting your time. Surely you're not going to place any credibility in that person's testimony.
You ain't mad at me, Mr. Hines.
You're my pal.
Yes, sir.
All right, you're excused, Mr. Morris. Thank you.
It's all right.
Mr. Hines, do you deny that it's possible for inmates at Welfare Island to obtain special privileges for themselves by buying these so-called tickets from you and or your associates?
I told you that I'm not interested in anything that Mr. Morrison had to say.
But we're interested, Mr. Hines, and so is the public. Let me refer you to a page one article of the New York Evening Post of April 27, 1934. Quote, sir, James J. Hines is the man referred to in the widespread reports that Vic March, Harlem racketeer, had political backing in building up the gang of favored convicts who ran the prison, lived in the hospital wards, peddled and used narcotics, brewed their own beer, brought females into the prison, collected daily rake-offs on gambling games, and ate the best food while the majority of the 1,400 inmates starved. End quote.
End smear. There's no new revelation there. That paper's been trying to hang me for years. But so far, there's no testimony that in any way connects me with Vic Marsh, Welfare Island, or tickets, or anything else.
Mr. Hines, excuse me, Mr. Hayden. Getting back to my opening remarks where I painted a rather grim picture of the crime situation in the city of New York, isn't it true, sir, that one of the major contributing factors to this situation is the circumstance that hardened criminals are allowed to roam the city streets at will, set free by a vicious practice known as parole jobbing? What is parole jobbing, Mr. Hines?
Well, allegedly, it's a system whereby a convict buys a parole.
From whom?
Well, allegedly from a politician, but two allegedlies don't make a fact. It's baloney.
I see. Now, in 1933, a report of the New York Society for the Prevention of Crime states that you are the leading parole jobber of the city.
Look, I'm the district leader. People in my district get into trouble. It's my job to help them. But I don't buy or sell paroles to anybody.
You flatly deny the accusation of the Society for the Prevention of Crime?
I would like to shove it down their collective throats.
Mr. Clerk, will you call Mrs. Patrick Thompson, please?
Mrs. Patrick Thompson.
Raise your right hand, please. Left hand of the Bible. You solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
State your full name.
Ellen Thompson.
Be seated, please.
Mrs. Thompson, will you look at Mr. Hines, please? Have you ever had any dealings with Mr. Hines?
Yes. Yes, I've had dealings with him.
Will you tell the committee of your experience, please?
Well, Pat, my husband, he was in with a bad bunch. They robbed a gas station. Pat was in it because we needed money. Don't get me wrong, I'm not trying to make out like he was framed or anything. He was in on it, and he got caught. Well, because it was a first offense, they sent him to Welfare Island for a year.
I see.
Well, I knew that if he spent a year there, he'd come up bad, permanent bad. Mm-hmm. So then I heard that if you talk to a politician, you could get somebody off. That for money you could get a parole.
And Mrs. Thompson, it was no secret what politician you had to see?
Oh, no. No, everybody said the same thing. They all said, go see Jimmy Hines.
I see. And Mr. Hines agreed to get your husband a parole?
Yes.
For a consideration?
For $1,000.
See. All right now, ma'am. Did you give him the money?
Well, I went out and I borrowed all I could. I hocked all the wedding presents, and I went where I work, and I got an advance on my salary. So I raised $1,000, and then I brought it to him.
And subsequently, Mrs. Thompson, did he get your husband released?
No.
He was not paroled?
No. No, I must have gone to see Mr. Hines about, I'd say a dozen times. He told me that things were hot, that there was an investigation going on, and we'd have to wait until he could do anything about it. Well, time went by, and by then Pat was due to get out anyway. So I went to Mr. Hines, and I asked my money back. Well, he didn't do anything for Pat. I didn't see why I shouldn't get my money back.
And Mr. Hines flatly refused to give you your $1,000 back, ma'am?
After a while, he wouldn't even see me. You know, I gotta laugh. Uptown, they keep saying, what a great man Jimmy Hines is. He's so good. He does so much for everybody. Sure he does. Do you know who pays for it? People like me. People who get in trouble and got no place else to go. He takes their money. He bleeds them. So he can play the big shot politician. You know, that $1,000 was all we had in the world. If you weren't going to help Pat, why did you take it? Don't you know what you do to people? You give them hope. You make them think everything's going to be all right. And then you walk out on them. You take their money and what have they got? What do you leave them? What kind of an animal are you? You got no heart. You got no feeling. Pat's life is ruined. My life's ruined. And you're sitting pretty, aren't you? You're sitting way up high in the sky, aren't you? I hope you die.
I hope you die.
Bailiff, will you help Mrs. Thompson back to the stand? Would you like the bailiff to get you some water, Mrs. Thompson? I have no questions, Mrs. Thompson. No, gentlemen, no pictures at this time, if you please. Mrs. Thompson, you going to be all right? All right. You may cross-examine, Mr. Hines.
I wouldn't think of it. And the least you can do, Mr. Chairman, is declare a recess and let this poor woman get her composure.
Very well. The chair will declare a short recess.
Mrs. Thompson.
You stay away from me. You stay away from me. You save your help for somebody you can steal more money from. You get away from me.
Jimmy Hines has tried to undo Mrs. Thompson's testimony with a typical political gesture, but his efforts were in vain. We'll rejoin the proceedings in just a moment to see how Hines answers Mrs. Thompson's charges, but briefly we'll return you now to our studios.
Hi, Bill.
Mr. Williams. Here you are, the usual.
No, Bill, no more. Give me a pack of Camels.
Camels? How come?
Well, the other night I was at a friend's house. I forgot my cigarettes and he gave me a Camel. That's funny. I used to smoke Camels. I liked them. Then for some reason or other I switched. Believe me, that's a mistake I'll never make again. That one Camel reminded me how great a cigarette can really taste.
Why don't you rediscover Camels? If you find yourself smoking more now, but enjoying it less, now's the time to change to Camels and start to really enjoy smoking again. The best tobacco makes the best smoke. Have a real cigarette. Have a Camel.
Down in the hearing room, Chairman McGrath has reconvened the session, and the questioning of Jimmy Hines, the powerful Tammany leader of New York City, continues.
Hines, I wonder if you'd care to comment on the previous testimony of Mrs. Thompson's?
I think I would, yes.
Very well, sir.
It is strange how the same set of facts can produce two such totally different pictures. Now listening to Mrs. Thompson, you'd think that I was a monster, a beast, a cold-blooded swindler, preying on the poor and the unfortunate. I did take her $1,000, and I spent it, and more of my own money on investigators. But her husband was no good and not entitled to a parole. Now, how am I going to tell her that?
Mr. Hines, how do you explain the fact that when Mrs. Thompson went around asking, where should I go to buy a parole for my husband, they all said, go see Jimmy Hines?
Because, young man, in my district, no matter what the problem, the answer is go see Jimmy Hines. Gentlemen, have you any idea how many people come and see me in the course of a day? Over 1,000. They come crowding into the office, and nobody gets turned away because, and get this, and understand this, they've got no other place to go. Have you any idea what a district leader does? Have you any idea what he is? Have you any conception of the role of a district leader in a community? Well, I'll tell you. May I get up on my feet?
Yes, certainly. Go ahead, sir.
My district is the 11th Assembly District, New York County. If you take a knife and cut through the social structure of the city, you would have the 11th AD. We got Harlem and Morningside Heights. We got Columbia University and a whole group of middle-class apartments and some of the most putrid slums this side of Casablanca. We've got people of every nationality, every race, every religion, every ignorance, every sickness, every hatred. The 11th Assembly District is like a gigantic stew pot, always simmering, always ready to boil over. And do you know who keeps the lid on that stew pot and keeps this keg of dynamite full of humanity from blowing up in the face of the city? One man only, the district leader. James J. Hines, wet nurse, father confessor, sugar popper, the butcher, the baker, the candlestick maker, the fixer, the finder, the plumber, the lover of the 11th AD. That's me, a district leader.
Now,
All right, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hines. Now, how did you reach this eminence, sir? Were you born in the district?
I was born on 44th Street and 2nd Avenue.
And when did you go into politics?
What do you mean, go into politics? Where I come from, the people where I come from are conceived in politics. Not like today, where politics is an ugly word.
Well, what we're trying to find out, sir, is when you personally first started on your political career.
That would be 1910. Jimmy Ahern was the district leader at that time. And when Tammany gave him the nod to go ahead, I jumped over the fence and ran against him for district leader. Boy, that was a fight. You know, a lot of us still carry the scars of it, but it was a real Donnybrook, and we had a lot of fun.
And did you won?
No, I lost. His boys stuffed harder and more often than my guys did.
I beg your pardon? Stuffed what?
Mr. Milan, do you know what kefilte fish is?
Yes, sir, I've heard of it.
It's a wonderful Jewish dish, kind of a stuffed fish. And what the good Jewish housefrau does to the fish, my boys did to the ballot boxes with the same delicious result.
And Mr. Hines, do you recommend this practice?
If you get to eat the fish, why not? No, wait a minute. Those were raw two-fisted days. People played for keeps. But you know what it did? What your pure ivory tower politics doesn't do, it's made for excitement. It's got the people involved. Not like today where they sit in the bandstand and drink bathtub gin and not care who wins or why they win.
And so you lost your first race as district leader, sir.
And the second. But the third time around, we won by 1,500 votes, and I haven't been out ever since.
Mr. Hines? You campaigned for the leadership of Tammany Hall at one time, did you not, sir?
Well, naturally, some of my friends thought I ought to try for it.
And you made a try.
Well, of course I made a try.
But the leadership of the Hall didn't welcome your candidacy with shouts of joy, did they, sir?
Mr. Smithers, you're a master of understatement. They had fits.
Yes, they did. Why were they against you?
You must mean old Charlie Murphy and his collection of iron hats. Why was he against me?
Yes.
For the simplest reason in the world, because he was in and I was out trying to get in. And in politics, that spells P-O-I-S-O-N, poison.
I see. Their antagonism was based on that simple rule of politics.
Oh, it's a simple rule, but real deadly.
Yes, sir. I think we can get another view of that situation. May we call Mr. Charles Murphy to the stand, please,
sir? Clerk, will you call Charles Murphy?
Charles Murphy! Charles Murphy, please!
Can I help you, Charlie?
You raise your right hand, please. You solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I swear to tell the truth, I do.
State your full name.
Charles Murphy.
Be seated, please.
Mr. Murphy, for purposes of identification...
Okay.
I'm sorry. For purposes of identification, for our record, sir... At the time James Hines was running for the leadership of Tammany Hall, you were the head of that organization?
Grand Sachem.
Yes, sir.
That's the official title.
Yes, sir. Now, Mr. Hines tells us that the only reason you opposed him was a simple rule of politics.
What a dirty liar he is.
That wasn't the reason.
He knows the reason. I told him the reason right to his face. And I'll repeat it now. And with relish. Look here. I was boss of the hall for a good many years. I was getting old and I was getting tired. I was looking around for a good young man to take my place.
You were willing to give up the leadership of the hall, weren't you, sir?
I was looking forward to it. I'd let it be known that I was ready to step down. All I wanted was a good man to come in and keep the hall going. We had some fine young district leaders. But the one who pushed hardest, the real hungry one, was him, Jimmy Hines. He had lots of backing, sure. He bought himself plenty of support. But I let it be known I'd stay alive to 140, if that's what it took to keep him out of the hall.
Now, Mr. Murphy, why were you so bitterly opposed?
What's that?
Sorry. Why were you so bitterly opposed to Mr. Hines, sir?
I'll tell you. No matter what you hear about the hall, one thing we never forget is the little people. They made the hall, and they made us.
the leader. We'd better not forget it. He doesn't have to forget it. You know why, Hines? I'll tell you why, because you never knew it. To you, they're not people, they're crumbs, nothings. To squeeze and squeeze, to use as lining for your pockets. I saw that in you from way back.
Now, don't use up your juice on me,
you
Charlie.
You shut up, you double-crossing Judas. He's rotten, tip to toe, clear through. For money, for power, he'll deal with the devil, and he does. With crooks, hoodlums, mobsters, rats. Looking at that Killarney push, you wouldn't believe it, but he's one of the biggest hypocrites in the world. One of the biggest. Doing favors for people. Forget it. He spent his whole life doing favors for one guy only, James J. Hines.
And believing this, you fought his bid for the leadership of Tammany Hall.
That's why I fought him. I knew that bringing him into leadership of the Hall would be like calling down the plagues of heaven on the people of New York. He'd crucify them. That's why I fought him.
Thank you very much, sir. I have no further questions.
Gentlemen, do you have anything further for Mr. Murphy?
No questions.
You may cross-examine, Mr. Hines.
A lovely opportunity. Good old Charlie Murphy, guardian of civic virtue. Oh, it's hard to believe. So the reason you opposed me was because you thought I'd endorse the city over to the devil if I was taken in as leader of Tammany Hall.
Huh? It's the truth.
And you felt that from the first time you saw me, eh?
I smelled it.
Well, what was the matter with your smeller in 1915 when I came to you with a business proposition to sell maltodextrin to the British government? Maltodextrin is used in brewing beer. He liked the proposition so much that he invested $175,000 in it. Didn't you, Charlie?
I don't remember.
You don't remember? Well, I'm reminding you. $175,000. Within a year, he'd made $500,000 profit. That smelt all right to him, and he was drooling for more. And he wanted to push out everybody else, including me. But I don't push so easy. I called his bluff. And ever since that day, he has hated my guts. Now, that's the reason you oppose me, isn't it, Charlie Murphy?
No, it isn't.
And it's got nothing to do with outraged virtue, or that you thought I was bedding down with thieves.
You're in with them so thick you couldn't get out if you wanted out, which you don't. Because you're rotten, and they're rotten. And you belong with them. You belong together. You belong with the rats, with Rostine, Larry Fay, your buddies, with Luciano, with Vic Marge, with Dutch Schultz. For protecting these lice, for turning them loose on the streets. You ought to be whipped within an inch of your life. You're one of the worst.
Charlie Murphy, boss of Tammany, suddenly has collapsed in the midst of a violent tirade against Jimmy Hines. The committee aides have rushed to his side. The call has gone out for a doctor. At this moment, all is confusion in the hearing chamber. We'll get back with a report on the condition of the ailing Tammany boss just as soon as word reaches us from the floor. In the meantime, we return you to our studios.
All girls, even sisters, are beautifully different, and they continue to prefer Helene Curtis SprayNet for their own different reasons. SprayNet comes in two distinctly different types of control, firm and soft, regular and super soft. Whichever you choose, the very name, Helene Curtis SprayNet, inspires confidence. Take regular SprayNet. Nothing equals its special way of holding firmly. Millions of women have been using it exclusively for years. Or choose super soft SprayNet, the tried and true way to hold curls softly. Never mind a separate styling spray. Recomb anytime. Super Soft lets you restyle without respraying. The sister sprays, Helene Curtis SprayNet, regular or super soft. And look, free. New Tender Touch Dry Skin Bath Oil with every $1.35 size of Helene Curtis SprayNet.
Down in the hearing room, Chairman McGrath has called for a short recess. He and the other members of the committee are now in a small room just outside this hearing chamber where Charlie Murphy, the Tammany boss, was carried following his sudden collapse during his testimony against Jimmy Hines. We understand that the aging Tammany leader is resting comfortably. The doctor in attendance states there is no reason for immediate alarm, but quite naturally, he will not be able to return to the stand. It'll still be a few moments before the committee reconvenes, so briefly, we return you to our studios.
This portion of The Witness was brought to you by Camel, the real cigarette. The best tobacco makes the best smoke. Speaking for Camel was James Daly.
Down in the hearing room, Chairman McGrath has called this session back to order, and the questioning of New York City politician Jimmy Hines continues.
Mr. Hines, I don't think you had a chance to complete your cross-examination of Mr. Murphy before he had his unfortunate collapse on the stand. In view of this, the committee will be very glad to hear any further comments that you may wish to make at this time on his testimony.
Boss Murphy is a tired, bitter old man. They say that age mellows a man, but in his case, he only seems to have disintegrated. And it's a pity, too, because in his day, he was a great, grand politician. And generous, too. Probably no man ever gave away more of New York in a lifetime. Fat city contracts, special privileges, streetcar franchises and the like. But I don't suppose this committee cares to go into that at this time, do you?
Well, Mr. Hines, we were hoping, sir, that you might care to comment on Mr. Murphy's assertion that you are closely connected with many underworld figures. He actually implied, sir, that you front for them.
To answer that would be to dignify it. I refuse to.
You deny all association with top underworld figures.
Look.
Is that right, Mr. Hines?
Look, I get around. Naturally, hoods happen to be in the same place where I am.
You know any of them socially, sir? Or any of them your intimate friends?
No.
No. Bailiff, would you take this picture to Mr. Hines, please? And Mr. Hines, would you look at this picture, sir? This picture was taken by a newspaper photographer at Madison Square Garden. Now, for purposes of identification, would you identify the man on the right, on your right in the picture?
It's a lousy picture.
Well, I think it's a remarkably good picture. It's a picture of James J. Hines. Do we agree, sir?
It might be.
Is it a picture of you, sir?
Okay, it is.
Thank you very much. Now, for the record, will you identify the man on the left in the picture, the one with his arm around your shoulder?
Well, he could be anybody.
It could be anybody, Mr. Hines, but it happens to be somebody.
Look, I get my picture taken every day.
With a man's arm around your shoulder? Will you tell us who the picture is of?
Young man, you will have to tell me.
Yes, sir, I will tell you. The other man in the picture who is so obviously glad to be in the picture with you is Dutch Schultz. Now, will you deny that, Mr. Hines?
Look, I am getting a little bit
sick and tired of these talks. Will you deny that, Mr. Hines?
Okay. I happen to know a couple shady characters. And I see them around as social figures or at sports events. But I happen to know a lot of other people, too. Now, why don't you ask me about them? I know Jimmy Walker. I know the two senators of New York. I know the governor. I know college presidents and philanthropists, all kinds of people, white, colored, big people and small people. Look, I'm in politics. It's my business to know people. What kind of a politician would I be if I built up a wall between me and the people?
All right, Mr. Hines. No one denies that as a politician, naturally, you must know all kinds of people.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Those are the first understanding words that have come from the committee today.
The question is, sir, have you ever used your political influence to obstruct justice?
Now, Mr.
No, I'll withdraw that. More specifically, have you ever acted as a political front for characters like Rothstein, Dutch Schultz?
Now, look,
it's a simple question.
Mr. Chairman.
It demands a simple answer, yes or no?
Well, in that case, the answer is no.
Oh, now, Mr. Hines, really, sir?
No.
Mr. Hines.
And no.
Very well, sir. Mr. Clerk, would you please call the Honorable Darcy Grant?
The Honorable Darcy Grant. The Honorable Darcy Grant, please.
About to give
us the truth,
the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help
you
God.
I do.
State your full name.
Darcy Hamilton Grant.
Seated, please.
Thank you.
Judge Grant, you are a magistrate in the city of New York.
That's right.
Will you tell the committee who appointed you to the bench there?
Mayor James J. Walker.
Now, you had certain sponsors who suggested your appointment to the mayor, no doubt.
Mr. Chairman, if I may save the committee's time.
Yes.
I admit my chief sponsor was Jimmy Hines. I admit it openly, sir. I admit it proudly.
Thank you. That's exactly what we wanted to know. Now, can you tell us on what basis Mr. Hines endorsed you so...
Now, who can answer that better than I?
All right. Then we'll accept your answer.
All right, because Darcy Grant was the best qualified man in the district. He's a fine lawyer and an upstanding citizen. He is honest, able, and sincere.
Able to do
and
what, sir?
I don't get you, young man.
Able to buy his way to a position on the bench? Is that what you mean?
I object to your insinuation, sir. I demand a retraction.
Well, I'd be very glad to give you one, sir, if you'll just answer a few questions for this committee.
I'll be very glad to answer any questions you care to ask. My
Thank
public
you,
and private life is quite beyond your reach.
Yes, sir. You were appointed to the bench on May 1920, is that right?
That's right.
Now, according to the sworn affidavit by the manager of the Beekman branch of the Bank of the United States, you drew out $20,000 one month prior to your appointment as magistrate. Is that correct, sir?
If the manager so states, I admit it's a fact.
Yes, sir, he does so state. And he also states in this affidavit, sir, that at your request, this $20,000 was drawn out in cash in small bills. Is that correct, sir?
Well, really, no, I don't recall.
Sir, you don't recall $20,000?
It was a business transaction, I presume.
Sir, when I intimated that you bought your position on the bench, you asked me to make a retraction. I'll be very happy to give you a retraction, sir, here and now, plus my personal apology. If you will explain to this committee what type of legitimate business transaction has to be consummated with $20,000 in small bills.
Good Lord, man, how do you expect me to answer a question?
You turned the money
like
over
that
to Jimmy Hines, didn't
here.
You, sir?
Mr. Chairman, I demand to be protected from these insinuations.
And I challenge Mr. Smithers to tell us the basis of that presumption.
Now, Mr. Hines, I will not tolerate these interruptions.
Yes, but am I to tolerate these innuendos?
That will be quite enough, Mr. Hines.
Darcy, I apologize to you for these honorable gentlemen.
Now, Judge, when you sit as a magistrate, most of the people who appear before you have been picked up for such misdemeanors as disorderly conduct, possession of narcotics, gambling, things like that, sir. Is that right?
The great number, yes.
And isn't it the fact, sir, that Jimmy Hines calls you dozens of times during every day you're in court?
No, I wouldn't say every
Does
day.
Does he ever call you while you're in court?
Yes, I suppose so.
And when he calls you, what do you and he talk about?
Oh, we talk about many things. On occasions, that's rare occasions, he may intercede for someone from his district, you know, some kid in trouble.
And he calls you at a time when you're right in the courtroom, is that right, sir?
Yes,
And if
but...
court is in session, you call a recess and immediately go to the telephone, is that right?
Well, Jimmy is a busy man. I wouldn't want to keep him waiting.
Now, Your Honor, when Hines calls you, when he tells you what cases he wants thrown out of court...
Now, wait a minute. Nobody ever said
that. All right, I'll withdraw the question. I'll rephrase it. Your Honor, when Mr. Hines intercedes in a particular case, don't you generally approach that matter with a certain degree of leniency?
Well, naturally, all things being even.
And that goes for those arrested on dope charges and even more so on gambling charges?
I refuse to consider gambling a capital crime, sir.
It's obvious from your record, sir. In the past 5 years, you've had 6,854 people brought before you charged with possession of policy slips. That's the numbers game. And that's an illegal form of a lottery. How many of these 6,854 arrested gamblers did you discharge on the basis of lack of evidence?
Well, I told you, I have no idea of the statistics.
Well, we do, sir. Let me refresh your recollection. Of the 6,854 arrested gamblers brought before you, you discharged 6,849. You held just 5 for trial. You're an extremely lenient man, Your Honor.
But you don't understand, sir. These were just small-time petty gamblers.
Petty gamblers? Arrested and brought before you, sir, were such men as Bo Weinberg, George Weinberg, Lulu Rosencrantz, Jules Martin, men who are known as the most vicious gunmen in the city.
Really? I didn't know that.
You didn't know they worked for the man who controls the policy racket?
No.
And you didn't know that the man who controls the numbers racket is Dutch Schultz?
No, I didn't know it.
And being lenient with these people, you were working for Schultz?
I was not working for Schultz. I was working for Jimmy Hines.
And Hines was working for Schultz?
Shut up, Darcy.
Please answer the question, Your Honor.
Look, can't you understand? I don't know anything about these people. I don't know who's big, who's little. I don't know one from the other. All I know is that Occasionally, Jimmy Hines wants somebody released.
And your allegiance to Jimmy Hines is greater than your allegiance to the law, sir?
No, that isn't so.
But you meet his demands?
Well, I don't mean to at all times, sir.
But no,
I try to be
criminal,
fair.
No criminal is found guilty in your court when you get a call from Jimmy Hines.
You don't understand the power that this man has. I owe a great deal to him. You just don't understand.
Yes, sir. I think I do understand.
Jimmy Hines is the man who had me appointed to my office. He's the only man who can have me reappointed. Look, if it wasn't me, he'd only appoint somebody else who'd obey his orders. That's the system. Don't blame me. Blame the system, his system. Don't blame me.
I have no further questions, Mr. Chairman.
I have no questions for the judge. He's your witness. You may cross-examine.
I wouldn't think of burdening my good friend Darcy with questions at this time. Let him go.
Very well, you're excused, Judge Grant.
Mr. Chairman...
You're excused, sir.
Perk up, it's not the end of the world.
Not the end of the world? Maybe not the end of your world, Hines, but certainly the end of mine. Everything's out in the open now. I'd be a fool if I didn't see that. If I sold myself to you, lock, stock, and barrel.
I told you once to shut up, Darcy.
Yes. And for once, I'm not jumping when you crack the whip. I'm finished. And the papers come out tomorrow, and they'll carry the news of my resignation. Here's the truth, gentlemen. My political last will and testament. You're right. You're absolutely right. Hines is the political front for Dutch Schultz. And not just the front, but their highest paid partner.
The one thing Jimmy Hines did not expect, the sudden passionate outburst against him by one of his staunchest political henchmen, Judge Darcy Grant. A short recess has been called. We return you now briefly to our studios.
Scuff it.
Yes, you can scuff it.
Spill on it.
Yes, you can spill on it.
Track dirt on it.
Track dirt on it, too.
Wipe, then buff, and the lasting shine comes back. It's new Aerowax. The shine lasts longer by far than other leading brands because only Aerowax has the lasting shine formula that shines back through roughest wear. The Aerowax shine lasts longer by far, saves 23 cents a quart over other leading brands.
When the sun shines on a newly cleaned window, look at how the streaks show up. What you need is Easy Off Push Button Window Spray. Seeing is believing. Put your windows to the Easy-Off Sunshine Test. See how easily Easy-Off spreads? No dripping, no powdery leftover, and when the sun shines bright, there's not a streak or a smudge. Keep your windows sunshine bright with new Easy-Off. Extra large size, only 49 cents. You save 10 cents.
Down in the hearing room, Chairman McGrath is just reconvening this probe into the alleged underworld connections of Tammany boss Jimmy Hines. We go now to the floor.
Gentlemen, I must congratulate this committee on its choice of witnesses. You couldn't ask for a more varied list of characters. We've had comedy, melodrama, and pathos. All very interesting and very entertaining, but I fail to see how any of this testimony relates to me.
We are delighted to have provided entertainment for you, sir. Now, once again, Mr. Hines... Judge Grant has testified here that you were the political front for Dutch Schultz and his numbers racket. Would you care to comment on his testimony, sir?
Judge Grant is an old friend of mine. The truth of the matter is he's too old for the job. Naturally, he comes here to make an 11th hour appeal. He knows I have no intention of supporting his reappointment. So he comes here, it's just a feeble attempt of an old man on his way out of office.
But you do not deny his accusation?
Of course I deny it. But it's rather sad for a friend to turn on you just to get his name in print.
Mr. Hines, may I ask, sir, where all your income comes from?
Sure, you may ask. It's none of your business, but you may ask.
It's the most perplexing thing, Mr. Hines. The income you derive from your office as district leader doesn't anywhere near approach the amount of money that you spend in any given year. You have a fine home, you drive an expensive car, you entertain royally, and it is a well-known fact, sir, that you go to the racetrack practically every day it's open, and you bet and you lose considerable sums of money.
Yes, sometimes I get lucky and it even things.
Do you have any bank accounts, Mr. Haynes?
I don't trust banks.
Let's see, no bank accounts, no sizable income from any traceable source, a lavish better at the races. What's missing from the picture, Mr. Hines?
Mr. Hayden, what do you suggest?
Mr. Hines, I suggest it might be the large sum of money you paid by Dutch Schultz for protecting his numbers racket.
And I suggest you try and prove it.
I will, Mr. Hines, I will. Now, sir, according to police records, the numbers racket operates chiefly in Harlem.
Yes,
it is
it's
your
a penny,
district,
nickels,
isn't it?
Dime operation.
Did you say pennies, nickels, and dimes?
Yes.
They add up, sir. Do you know what Schultz's average take is in 1 year?
I told you I never knew Schultz.
Over $18 million a year. Are you trying to tell us now that you know nothing about this gigantic gambling operation which operates openly all over your own district?
I am not trying, I am telling you. I know nothing about it.
Well, let me educate you, Mr. Hines. Thousands of people select the number from 1 to 999 every single day. A winner is paid at the rate of 600 to 1. A 10-cent bet in your district can win you $60.
That beats the horses. Hey, you have to try that sometime.
Mr. Hines, our investigations show that Schultz moved into the numbers racket in 1932. He merged all the bankers together with strong-arm men like Julie Martin, Lulu Rosencrantz, Legs Diamond, Bo and his brother George Weinberg. He squeezed the numbers racket dry. He murdered competitors. He beat up collectors. And he helped himself to one of the largest fortunes in organized crime. He couldn't do it alone, Mr. Hines. He had to have protection.
What are you trying to say?
I am saying, sir, that with so many people involved in this racket, the bettors, the collectors, the players all over your district, the winners, it was virtually impossible for it to go on without protection, and you must agree with me, sir.
I am not the police commissioner.
But as the most powerful district leader in this city, sir, you could provide that protection if you wanted to, couldn't you? That is, if your own take was high enough, sir.
Mr. Chairman, we've been through all this. What are you trying to do? Tie me into the policy gangsters? Look, the policy boys have been dead and gone a long time ago now. Look, they're all dead. Legs Diamond is dead. Dutch Schultz is dead. Rosencrantz is gone. Julie Martin is gone. Bo Weinberg is dead,
what
too.
What about his brother George Weinberg, sir?
Well, I don't know what happened to him. The police have been looking for him for over 4 years now. You might as well consider him dead, too.
You're wrong, Mr. Hines. He's not dead. He happens to be under police custody right outside this room. Mr. Chairman, may we now call Mr. George Weinberg?
Call George Weinberg, Mr. Clerk.
George Weinberg here. Hey, now look, what is this?
Now,
what's
Mr.
this
Hines,
all about now?
Now, sir, will you listen to me? I want to offer you this last opportunity before Mr. Weinberg testifies to tell this committee voluntarily of your own free will about your association with Dutch Schultz.
I will tell you nothing. I don't know this George Weinberg. And whatever he says is a lie. You hear that? I'm telling you. It's a lie, a lie, a lie.
Hello, Pops. It's been a long time, huh?
I object to the parading of criminals before me.
Pops, save it. Save it, Pops.
Look, I won't sit here and have any more of this filthy accusation.
Sit down, Mr. Hines. Sit down, sir. All right, Mr. Clerk. Swear in, Mr. Weinberg.
Raise your right hand, your left hand in the Bible. You solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
Sorry, Pops. I got it. I'm telling the truth.
State your full name.
George Weinberg.
Be seated, please.
Mr. Weinberg, before we proceed with further questioning, for the record, are you now in the custody of the District Attorney of New York?
Yeah, in person, I... Yeah, we've been having a... Well, what you call a conference.
Thank you. Now, we understand that you have been a fugitive for the last 4 years, Mr. Weinberg. Did you give yourself up, or were you arrested?
Yeah, well, I... DA's guys busted in me down in Philly. I surrendered. I mean, as three cops... Machine gun, maybe a deal with the DA. Yeah, I surrendered.
The district attorney has been investigating the numbers racket. In this connection, have you agreed to turn state's evidence?
Well, I got no choice. It's the old squeeze. I didn't want to do it. You know that, Pops. But, well, what's the difference now anyway? I mean, everybody's dead. The Dutchman, Lulu. We're the only ones left. Even Bo's dead. It's my brother, Bo. He's in the bottom of the East River in a case of cement. Yeah. Hey, Pops, you know Dutchman killed Bo? Well, we're the only ones left.
I tell you, I never saw this man in my life before.
Mr. Weinberg, did you ever work for Hines? Did you ever electioneer in his district?
Oh, Pops was always the most popular guy.
But in a close contest, your gang saw that the votes went the right way.
When your Pops is our buddy, I mean, you help a guy when he's your buddy if he needs your help.
You persuaded voters by beating them up.
Well, if the going got rough, maybe some of the boys gave him
some help.
Look,
this is a frame-up.
Oh,
go ahead. Print everything. For the rest of the week, you'll be printing retractions. They're trying to frame me.
Hey, Pop. What's the difference now, Pop? The DA's got it all. I mean, he's pulling everybody in, even the little guys, the cops we fixed, the judges you paid off, the collectors, the runners. He's even got some of your people. I mean, the secretaries and the party workers. Ah, come on, he's got things sewed up tight. Pop.
Weinberg, did you work for Schultz in the policy racket?
Oh, yeah, I was his right arm.
And you know who arranged for protection?
Sure I know.
Was it Hines? Was Hines the man who saw to it that the policy games went unmolested?
Yeah, it was Jimmy.
Shut up, you idiot.
Oh, what's the difference? The DA's got it all, Pops.
Mr. Weinberg, how much did Hines get paid?
He got about a deal a week and a bonus.
$1,000 a week?
Yeah, he earned it.
What was the bonus for?
Well, election time, he... Dutchman used to write a check to take care of the right guys. Huh?
In other words, Dutch Schultz's money was used to promote public officials into office. Is that right?
Well, that money buys votes. You know, I mean, money buys police. Well, is it Dutch's money made Jimmy a big man?
How much bonus did Dutch Schultz pay Mr. Hines?
Well, in the 32, I give him about $30,000.
They never paid me a cent. I wouldn't touch that filthy money.
Oh, he got it all right. The Dutchman made out the check, and I delivered it personal. I mean, I paid the loot.
Prove it. Show me the check.
The DA's...
Show me the check with my name on it.
Oh, I didn't have your name. You know, he made it out to your bookkeeper, but the DA's got the bookkeeper too, Pops. I mean, why don't you give up? He's got everything. He's got your code, I'm telling you, Pops.
He lies again, lies. Look, are you going to believe this man, this louse? I've been district leader for 42 years. My people are behind me. I don't need gangsters and lice like that.
Hey, Pops, now watch it. You hold it. You watch out who you call a loss. Don't think I'm dead. Did you think I was dead? I mean, when you counted the loot. What did you think of that? And when you counted those votes, you think that was dirty? Oh, look, I can't beg off, but neither can you. You know, the only difference between us is that the cops never bothered you, but... Oh, there's no difference now. I mean, you try to buy your way out of this, huh? Try to do anything now without the Dutchman and me and the cops and everybody to prop you up. You're through, Pops. You hear me? You're through.
All right, Mr. Weinberg. I think we have no more questions for you, Mr. Hines.
Get him out of here.
You're excused.
Look, Jimmy, I didn't want this to happen. It had to come. You knew it. I mean, look what happened to the whole bunch. They're dead. You think you'd get off, huh?
Look, you excused him. Get him away from me. Get him out of here!
All right, officers, all right.
And listen to me! All of you, I said listen to me! I've been in politics for almost half a century now. I know all the tricks. They brought me here today, and they set out to smear me. And they have done their job well.
Now, just a minute, Mr. Hines.
Just a minute, Mr. Chairman. Do you, the DA, or anybody think you can make a case stick against me? I run this city. I built the political machine in this town. And there isn't an office holder in government who doesn't respect me and doesn't swear by me. They'll not tolerate this kind of slander. The people will not tolerate. You think you've heard the end of me? Well, wait. Just wait. Tomorrow you'll find out who's boss of this town. Tomorrow you'll find the kind of a man that you're dealing with. Tomorrow you'll know Jimmy Hines.
All right, may I have your attention, please? Mr. Hines, it is not a very pleasant task for me to have to censure a man like you. Now, you have here tonight very eloquently defended the principles and functions of the district political leader. Let the record show this committee has no quarrel with that principle. We object only to its corrupt use, sir. Now, we don't deny that you have endeared yourself to many of your constituents, Mr. Hines. Nor do we deny your obvious and outstanding qualities of leadership. Now, herein lies the real tragedy of James J. Hines. You have exploited these talents for self-interest. And I think we have shown here tonight that you have abused the trust so many have placed in you. Politics is a proud profession, you said, Mr. Hines. It is indeed, sir. But not your kind of politics. And not your brand of benevolent dictatorship. And certainly not your known association with gangsters. No, Mr. Hines, this is not your city. You do not own this town. The people do. And the people will no longer endure your contemptuous philosophy. The public be damned. This hearing is adjourned.
On March 24, 1939, prosecuted by New York District Attorney Thomas E. Dewey, Jimmy Hines was convicted of conspiracy to defraud the public. In the midst of that trial, George Weinberg committed suicide. Because of his advanced age, the judge imposed a sentence of 4 to 8 years at Sing Sing. He was paroled on September the 12th, 1944. One of the conditions of his parole was that he never again engage in political activity. He died on March 26, 1957, at the age of 81. Our witness tonight, James J. Hines. Next week, the witness will be Ma Barker, the infamous woman who raised her 4 sons to be vicious criminals. Ma Barker, the first and only woman ever termed public enemy number one in the history of U.S. crime.
This is Eric Fleming. If you've the spirit of adventure, you'll hit the trail with the men of Rawhide tomorrow night on most of these stations.
The preceding program was pre-recorded. The open road, stretching anywhere. A highway to exciting new places, where every week 2 young travelers find adventure on Route 66. Here is the bold new dramatic series starring Martin Milner and George Maharis, as 2 eager young adventurers traveling the open road in search of action, life, and fortune. At every crossroad and beyond every hill and curve waits a new thrill, a new challenge, a new danger. Sometimes they're lucky. Other times they have to fight for their lives. Sometimes peril is the price for wandering to the wrong places. But whatever the road ahead holds, one thing Todd and Buzz always find is excitement. And you will, too, when you join them on Route 66 every Friday night on most of these stations.